is Rodney Stotts. I'm a licensed falconer. I got started in falconry because I've always wanted to possess my own birds so that I'm able to go to neighborhoods and teach young people about raptor education, falconry, and the environment. The opportunity came where I'm working with injured raptors for, like I said, like the last 15, 16 years. So during that time of working with injured birds, I got to meet other people who actually hunt birds, which in actuality, it's saving the birds' lives. So I wanted to be able to save the birds' lives because they actually helped save mine. Doing what I was doing with even with the injured birds, we had one bird that is chamber raised, so she was able to be given to a nonprofit who's fully flighted, and I used to work with her all the time. So it just, that passion grew more and more. So it's not that I love birds more than any other animals. I love all animals. I just, with these birds, they just bring out the best in me and everyone. Being a falconer has truly impacted my life because it opened up opportunities for me to go into almost every neighborhood. And I can pull those birds out and they cross every color barrier, economic barrier, it doesn't matter. When you see these birds, you instantly fall in love. You feel this connection. So that's one of the things that it helped me to do, and it really saved me because I would have had too much time on my hands to do nothing. And having these birds and having to train them and having something else that you have to care about and do for keeps you grounded. Before falconry, before I joined with the nonprofit, with the Earth Conservation Corps, I was a drug dealer. I sold coke, weed, pills, whatever I had to sell, I would sell it. The whole street life, that's what it was. That wake up, it wasn't overnight, it was a process. And you start understanding that it's more to life than the street. It's more to life than this corner. It's more to life than sitting here with a gun, sitting here trying to flip this, having to duck these people. It's more to life than that. I actually started doing volunteer with the teens because a lot of families, disadvantaged youth, I don't like that word, however, that's what it classified as, couldn't afford to have a $300, $200, $100 bird show going on at all. That whole, everything about being able to give to young people that excitement that I had, that I wish I was exposed to earlier in life, because maybe I wouldn't have done some of the things that I ended up doing because of that. So if I don't like that term, if I can save one, I don't like that term, because I want as many young people, older people, people period, to one, take more stock into our environment, two, in your lives, in your kids' lives. I mean, we can do so much more to help ourselves. I mean, it's just, yeah, and with these birds, it's just tremendous. And
also,
like this one?
Right, that cage that go on the inside, I'm gonna put a cage like that on the inside of here. We're gonna close this in off. So as you put your mice in, all your mice will go in through this bottom. Then when you put the mice in, you'll close that door, and you'll latch something on, now the mice can't get out. Then as we ride, you see the hawk, you set the trap, you see the other hawk, you set the trap, and you go away. Now the mice are crawling all around. Hawk comes flying in, lands on the trap, trying to get to the mice, go to take off, then he's caught. And you gotta make all of these hoops. That's not enough. You gotta put more hoops on there, and I'll show you how you make the hoops. So you gotta make the little hoops, time down, and then we'll take the hot glue gun and we'll glue them where they sit straight up. So now when the bird comes in, you got a better chance of getting them because none of your hoops are laying down. So we'll take a little hot glue gun. See, actually you can see some right here. The little spots right here, this is the hot glue that we put on there to keep the hoops open and up. So when a bird come in, same thing. When you're out trapping birds, you'll typically see a bird sitting up in the top of a tree. You want to get as close to the bird without spooking them off as possible. You'll build what's called a balsatchery trap. and you can actually take that trap and you put your mice on the inside or your pigeon or whatever prey item, and you try to get it as close to that tree or line wherever that bird's sitting, and then you want to move away from it. If the bird is hungry enough, he'll come down, he'll land on top of that trap. And once he lands on top of the trap, he's trying to actually get to the prey items that you have on the inside. Well, you have these little hoops all around the top of the trap that actually locks around their feet, hopefully. So as they go to take off, they're now trapped around their feet through the hoops. And now you have your bird. You get up on him, you get a hold of him, cut him loose. You want to check his feet, check his ears, check his wings, check his crop, things like that. Make sure he's healthy and make sure that it's a juvenile. And if it's a juvenile, you have your bird from there and you start training.
This is the freezer here. This is my bird's freezer, my raptor's freezer. And this particular box right here is my Eurasian Eagle Owl Lola. This was the first owl, first bird that Wings Over America had registered to them. She passed away, she had cancer. So I'm actually gonna bury her up at Oak Hill during the springtime so that she'll be able to stay up there with me forever. So I'm gonna keep her, I'll bury her next spring. And here I keep all of the mice and rats for the birds. I keep a set of wings to make my lures out of for my falcons, a set of bird wings, so that when you wanna train your falcon, this is what you can train them to. I got a set of quail wings in here. So you'll put them together and you put a little string around them and make your bird fly to them with a little piece of meat on it to help train them to the lure. I have a squirrel in here for them. I have, in this bag, it's a goose. And what I try to do is keep an abundance.
What's that?
These are rats here. Wintertime is, I'll really use the rats because you'll feed the birds so many baby mice that it sometimes it's better just to give them a nice size rat and let them eat that whole day as opposed to keep having to give them mice, because you can actually end up giving them about 12, 13 mice a day, where one nice size rat will fill them up for that whole day, day and a half. You don't have to worry about them being cold at night. You put enough body fat on them to keep them. And I have another thing of mice, so I'm actually going to make a run, because this will only last about two and a half months once winter really hits. So I have another pickup to do October the 8th, where I'll get about six more mice and at least two more rats, and that'll get me through the whole winter and spring of training the birds to hunt with them. And then I'll release the birds next spring and start all over again. So I'll have to get even more mice and start the whole process all over again.
Well, I feed mine every day. Depends on, you can do what's called, you can feed your bird up where you kind of overfeed him where he's not going to even fly. So you want to do that from time to time just to keep him healthy. You never want to keep him always at flight weight. So you always want to bulk him up every so often, let him get that extra weight on him, exercise him back down properly. So, I mean, they all eat the same, and I feed them every day, sometime every other day. Then it depends on if it's the winter or the summer. Just once a day. Yeah. Oh, yeah. You can make sure that they eat enough during that one feeding, and see, what I try to do is fly them while I'm feeding them, so I keep that connection with them coming to me. So if something ever going on and I have them out and they're up in a tree or something and I need to leave immediately and I need to get them back to me, that's just a way of getting them back to you a lot easier of always having them to fly to the glove once you first get them to start flying.
This here is a picture of Lola. She was painted by a young lady named Heather Stevens for me. I keep this picture hanging up in my home along with the plaque that was given to me with Lola's footprint. So I always have something to remember her by here with me after I take her the body up to Oak Hill and bury her up there. So I just want to thank Heather for painting this for me, because this was very, very, very special to me.
How long did Lola pass away?
Lola passed away about 4.5 months now, 5 months ago. And so I look at this picture every day, and it's one of the things that make me keep going out to do what I have to do. And we lost her due to cancer, but we had her for about 4 years in total, so it was real good to at least have her. She was a very aggressive bird. This was the meanest bird that I've ever worked with, but we got her tamed down so much that she was able to start doing shows and things of that nature, so she did get to have a really good quality of life before she passed. Falconry keeps me at peace because no matter what's going on, I still have these birds to take care of. They're with me every day. I took on that responsibility of getting them. And no matter what's going on, I know that I still have an obligation because I made promises to Monique Johnson, Gerald Hewlett, Benny Jones, and James Metley. Those were four of the original 9 core members that started Earth Conservation Corps with me back in 92 that are no longer with us. 3 were murdered, 1 passed from health complications. However, we all made promises that no matter what, we would keep that spirit going. And so when I'm feeling down, I call on one of my angels. They talk to me in my ear and tell me, go get the bird, go outside and put a smile on somebody else's face. And the moment I see them smile, I smile. Biggest supporter is not even the word for it, man. I've told everybody numerous times, man, even when I was doing things I wasn't supposed to be doing. My mother wasn't proud of the things I was doing. She was always proud of me. Now she's proud of the things I'm doing and proud of me. So it's a big difference, man. So yeah, that, you mean biggest supporter, that's beyond. Now I have other people who do show a lot of support for me. And I mean, Akima Price, Heather Stevens, we have Sean Hayes. This is a guy, he's a falconer down in California, who read about me and sent me falconry equipment so that I can now use to go into the neighborhoods and teach young people and actually leave gloves with them and hoods with them and things with them that show, gives them that sense of, I took pride in something, I did something, I took peace in this, you know. So, I mean, I have a lot of them, Shanti Morgan, I mean, you name it, man. I have a lot of people that really, really care about young people. Selena Brown, they really care about young people. They, all these people run some sort of program designed to help young people. So we all have a connection together because that's our goal, to help as many young people, give them as many skills, be a jack of all trades, master of none, so you can always feed your family. You know that usually when I take that off, something to eat right there, so that's what he really looking for, something to eat. So when you want to keep them nice and calm, you can put their hood on them, you still check their crop, the whole nine. It ain't about them doing something to you, it's just the fact that they're sight hunters. So when you want to keep them nice and calm and you don't want them agitated on nothing or nothing to distract them, you just put their hood on them, and that's it. This is where I actually, this spot right here actually is where I trapped my very first bird, which was a North American kestrel that I actually named Monique after the young lady that was working with me. So all of my birds, the names, I name my birds after people that we've lost. And unfortunately, over the last 60 days, we've lost 7 people, and we have one that's in the hospice now. So, and this was in the last 60 days. So all the birds I end up trapping, I name after people that meant something in our lives. So I need to trap about the limit that I can trap. However, I do education with them. So I'm trying to build a raptor sanctuary up at Oak Hill to bring at least 30, 40 non-releasable birds, where I can now bring 50, 60 young people up there at a time to teach them raptor education, teach them how to take care of the birds. And what that'll actually do, if they would like to go work for a zoo, a vet, things of that nature, at least they had some sort of interaction with these exotic animals, exotic birds, that they would know something more about it than the average person. Up here, we're gonna have the education center. We're gonna have a few computer labs up here, and this is where we'll actually fly the birds up through the raptors and hold the shows. We wanna
get this done immediately. This is a top priority. To put a roof on here is estimate is about $40,000-$50,000. So trying to get places like Home Depot, Lowe's to donate the wood, some people to come out and donate some time and help get this place together so we can give something back to the young people. Give them something else to do besides sit out on the corners, get arrested, get in trouble, get themselves killed over nothing. It's one of the things that helped save me, so I want to try to help save others. Through Wings Over America, we work with DC. We got it reserved to do a nature center there. We wanted to have a spot where young people can come out and actually do hands-on. Not so much of just walk around, oh, I saw this, I saw this, I saw this. And the opportunity arose for us to get the property up at Oak Hill because they closed the youth detention center and they built what's called New Beginnings. And so with that land back there, we were able to bless to get it. And we got the lease for it. So now we're hitting the ground running. And I'm trying to build at least to hold at least 30 different Raptors there so we can bring young people up, have them take care of them, feed them, train them, and the ones that are non-releasable will actually teach the young people, have them to actually do shows. So just say if we get a particular neighborhood to come up, that neighborhood comes up for that week. Well, on that Friday or that Saturday, what we would like to do is have the people that took place in the program to actually do a Raptor presentation for their neighborhood. Because I've been talking to a lot of the neighborhoods and they have a multi-purpose room or something where the tenants could all come to, and the ones who actually took part in it would actually do a Raptor presentation for their neighborhood. And who knows how many spirits that left, you know? So as long as you see something that you know you can do, it can help you in any way, do it. And this is one of the things that I found that helped me help so many others. So, everyone loves it. Most police officers were shocked because they'd never seen a black Falconer before. Other than that, I mean, everyone's positive, supportive, because they know where I used to be and things that we used to do to what we're trying to do now. And we want to stop this nonsense, these young people not having something to do. You know, we constantly hear people say, well, young people they don't want to do anything. Yes, they do. If you give them an opportunity, yes, they do. Because if properly funded, there's no way that 200, 300, 400 youth from south, from southeast, northwest, from DC, period, the inner city, wouldn't be interested in Falconer. There's no way.